At time, the harmonic oscillator, the basis in which the Hamiltonian is diagonal, it was this basis n, right? In the Dagger power n, square root of n factorial on the ground state, and this n, m are orthonormal. In the Hamiltonian, in this using this creation annihilation operators, a dagger commutator is equal to 1, is written as a dagger a plus 1 half, right? So this contains all one needs to discuss the harmonic oscillator, contains everything, right? And also we learn how to go to the more intuitive picture of x-dependent wave functions, right, where the wave functions are defined psi n of x as a function of x, where x is the spatial direction, so this is v of x, this is x. Right. They are defined to be as xn, right? Because this is what we do. We project this abstract state on the x basis, eigenstates of the position operator, right? And we got a way to write down these functions because by using this expression for n, right? And writing a dagger as x plus ip, p was the derivative, no, the usual map. We could write this, so in particular psi zero was the ground state wave function was up to some normalization e to the minus x square over 2, right, where x is the dimensionless, x hat, say. Then one can write it in terms of x. Remember that x hat, x is x hat times some quantity carrying the dimension of a length, which is h bar m omega, right? Right? So then you can write this in terms of x if you wish. So this is a Gaussian like that, right? This is a ground state wave function. And if you want the probability density, you have to take psi zero x modulus square, say part of a p of x probability density, where here you have chosen n in such a way that this is normalized to 1, right? Integral dx psi zero x modulus square is equal to 1. And the same for the psi n's, of course. Okay, this is the picture in this basis of eigenstates of the Hamiltonian, and what we observed and what you have must have checked is that in this state the this relation delta x delta p grows with n, right? This is something like h bar 2n plus 1 or something, I don't remember now.
Over 2.
Yeah. So for n equal to 0, this is h bar over 2, which is the minimal possible value for delta h, delta x, delta p, right? But in general, as you increase n, this grows, and so this becomes very far from the classical picture, right? Where you would like to have delta x, delta p, the minimum, right? Because classically, delta x delta p is zero, right? Okay, so there are states which one can introduce, which are combinations of these states, which have the right property to be as close as possible to the classical picture. These are called the coherent states, so let me describe them. Okay. So they will be denoted by this alpha, where alpha is a complex number, not real, complex number. And they are linear combinations of these n's, but involving infinite number of n's. So there will be alpha will be sum over n from 0 to infinity, cn alpha n, where these are the coefficients of this expansion, and this is what we have to find, what to fix, what are the cn alphas, right? But so how we arrive to this, so this is, how do we arrive to this alpha, how they are defined? Well, we want to, we define the alpha to be the state in such a, which is close as possible to the classical state. What do we mean by that? Okay. So classically, you can rewrite the equation of motion for the classical harmonic oscillator using these variables, x plus I, the complex variables, right? After all, it's just a change of coordinates. Instead of using x and p, you can use a dagger. If you treat them as a classical coordinates, classical variables, then h is just h bar omega. Let me use the notation alpha dagger alpha, where these are classical things, right? And the equation of motion in terms of alpha and alpha dagger just give you this solution. Okay? And alpha dagger is just the complex dagger, it means star here because they are numbers, not operators, right? So alpha star will be the complex conjugate of it. So you can rewrite the equation of an harmonic oscillator instead of using x and p, which involve cosine and sine, introducing this complex combination, which involves exponentials, but it's the same thing, right? And the Hamiltonian itself, once you have this solution, is very simple, is h bar omega alpha 0, right, the constant, this is a constant of integration, right, mod square, right, because of this, right? The phase drops, obviously the Hamiltonian is time independent, clearly, right, this is the classical picture, right. Okay, so we would like to have a state, alpha, such that in this state, we have a situation which is similar to this. So, for example, we would like that A, so here now, I mean, these are numbers. In quantum mechanics, A and A dagger are operators. Now, we take expectation values of this and we get numbers, which are the things that we observe, right? So, something like this, right? Okay. So we would like that this is some complex number, say at time t equal to 0, this is, let me call it alpha, okay, which is the analog of this. Okay. And you can, by the way, the expectation value, okay, whenever you have some observable, say, O, the expectation value of O obeys an equation of motion, which is this, which is very similar to the classical equation of motion, right? This you can derive because, you know, what is this O? O is psi of t, O psi of t, right? Then you act with this on psi of t here and psi of t here, you get precisely this structure, because from here, you know, psi of t is e to the minus I h t over h bar, right, psi of 0, here is the Hermitian conjugate, you differentiate this, and you get this structure here, right? So this is at some time t equal to 0, we say the expectation value of A in this state alpha is some complex number alpha, which is the analog of this, okay? This is one thing that we can always do. But the next is a stronger statement, because we would like also the Hamiltonian to be the quantum Hamiltonian to be something like that. So the expectation value of H in the state alpha, now quantum Hamiltonian, we would like to be, at least for alpha to be very large, to be H bar omega alpha modulus square. Remember that H bar H is this, no? Now, if you neglect this half compared to this part here, okay, then you would like this to be H bar omega alpha mod square, like the classical case. Okay? These are the two conditions, one condition and two and second condition. These two conditions fix the state alpha. Imposing these two conditions fixes this, what the state alpha is. Okay? How do you see that? Well, these two conditions imply the following, they imply a very sort of strange thing, that the state alpha, so let me state the what I and II imply that the state alpha is an eigenstate of A with eigenvalue alpha. Okay? Alpha is a complex number. Okay? I claim that these two things imply that. Okay? How do we see that? Well, consider the state A minus alpha, alpha. Okay. This is some state. Okay. Now, take the norm of this state. What is this? This is this and the Hermitian conjugate bra, right? This is the same as alpha A dagger minus alpha star, complex conjugate, times A minus alpha, right? This is what it is, no? Cat and bra. Now let's open up this thing here. This is alpha A dagger A, right? Then the diagonal test minus alpha mod square, right? Because alpha star alpha is alpha mod square. And then we have minus alpha A dagger minus alpha star A on alpha, right? Okay. Plus here, right? Now, so this is what? Alpha A dagger A, by this condition, the expectation value A dagger A, which is actually here, this implies that this is equal to alpha A dagger A is equal to alpha mod square. This is the second condition, is actually this, right? So this is again alpha mod square here plus alpha mod square. What about these terms here? So this is the second one, is precisely using condition I, is alpha star alpha, right? So this is minus alpha mod square. And this is the Hermitian conjugate of this. This implies that alpha A dagger alpha is alpha star, right? Take the complex conjugate of this. So this is again minus alpha square. So what do we get? We get zero. This is equal to zero. So this state, A minus alpha applied to alpha, is a null state, is a zero null state. So this means it must be zero, because the only state which has zero norm is the zero state. So A minus alpha on the state alpha is zero. Right? Which is just this equation, right? Take this on the other side, is this. So this implies these two conditions that we impose, that the expectation value of A is some number, complex number alpha. The expectation value of H is alpha modulus square, imply this fact here. So we have to find a state which is an eigenstate of the A operator, the annihilation operator. Okay? How do we do that? Well, just impose that this is true. So write alpha as a linear combination of the ends. As I wrote before, this is sum over Cn alpha of n, right? And we have to find what are the C. No? Then we impose this condition. We apply A on this. This is equal to what? Sum over Cn alpha, A on acting on n. Remember that A acting on n is what? Yeah, n minus 1, but we need a coefficient also, not just,
Square root of n.
So we use this. So this is square root of n, n minus 1, right? And this is from 0 to infinity, and this must be sum over n, 0 to infinity, alpha, no, Cn alpha, n, right?
Okay,
so then we compare the two sides. Here we shift n to be, say, n, this is n plus 1, this is n plus 1 from 0, right? And we compare the two sides and we equate the two coefficients or correspond to the same state n. And what we get? We get that Cn plus 1 of alpha is alpha Cn of alpha over square root of n plus 1, right? There is a recursive relation which relates Cn plus 1 to the previous one, Cn. Now, if you iterate this relation, you get an expression for Cn of alpha in terms of what? Of C0, the first one. Right, that is not fixed. And this is what? Alpha to the power n, because each step there is an alpha, and then square root of n factorial, because each time you pick square root of n, n minus 1, and so on, times C0, right, of alpha. So we have almost fixed our state, right, because all the Cn's are written in terms of a single one, so there is an overall number to be determined, but the rest is fixed, right? So, this is called the coherent state. Alpha is C0 of alpha, and then sum over n from 0 to infinity, alpha to the power n, square root of n factorial, and this is n. Is almost fixed. But of course, we have to impose that it is normalized, right? Impose that alpha is 1, right? This will fix everything up to an overall phase, right? So we have to compute this. What is alpha? Well, it's this times the conjugate the bra. So we have a double sum, right? C0 alpha mod square. And then we have sum over n m alpha to the power n alpha star to the power m square root of n factorial square root of m factorial, and then we have n, right? This is what it is. But we use orthonormality, which was written here. So this is delta nm. So the sum reduces to reduces to this, right? This is C0 mod square, and this is sum over n alpha modulus square to the power, say, n. No? This is square root of n factorial, square root of n factorial is n factorial. That's all. So this is what? This must be equal to 1, but this is C0 mod square e to d alpha modulus square, right? From which it follows that C0 up to a phase that we fix to be 0, we choose 0 phase, is the square root of this, is e to the minus alpha mod square over 2, right? So our coherent state now is fixed, apart from the usual ambiguity of the phase, which is irrelevant for physical observables. So alpha is e to the minus alpha mod square over 2 sum over n alpha to the n over square root of n factorial. This is the coherent state. So you see it involves an infinite sum of all the n's, involves all the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian, not just the final number. Right? This comes from the fact that it is an eigenstate of A. So this is the coherent state, normalized to 1. Okay? And it depends on this complex. What is the meaning of this complex number alpha? Well, alpha is also is the expectation value of, right? But A, we said, these are the dimensionless variables, right? A is x hat plus I p hat over square root of 2, right? So A contains what? The expectation value of x and the expectation value of p, right? This is x hat plus I p hat over square root of 2. The real part of alpha is related to the average position, and the imaginary part of alpha is essentially the average momentum of the state. And alpha star is the complex conjugate. Alpha star is x minus I p hat. Now, if you want to restate, you can restate or invert it. X, the average value of x is, take the sum of these two, right? Is alpha plus alpha star over square root of 2. If you want to put, use an x which has dimension of a length, you will have to put for x is square root of h bar m omega and then alpha plus alpha star over square root of 2. And p will be the other, right? Alpha minus alpha star over square root of 2 and then an I here and then square root of m h bar omega. This has the dimension of the length, this is the dimension of the momentum, so this is the expectation values, of course. These are numbers. Okay. Alpha is a complex number. It has a real part and imaginary part. The meaning of X, the real part is that it is the essentially the average position, and the imaginary part is the average momentum in that state. These are the meaning of these two numbers. So given the average position, the average momentum, you construct a state in this way, where this enters, this number enters here. Notice this is a complex number, so these are complex numbers, not real numbers. So this is the meaning. Now, I claim that in this state, alpha, the claim is that we justifies this the interpretation of these states as semi-classical states. The claim is that in the state alpha, delta x, delta p, for any of these states, for any alpha, is equal to h bar omega over 2. So the bound is saturated, it's the minimal possible bound, it's the minimal possible value, h bar omega over 2.
Omega.
Yeah, omega is not there, of course. Yeah, h bar. So this is the minimal value, possible value, which in the case of the states n was taken only for n equal to 0. The ground state had this property, but the excited states had this value to grow with n, linearly with n. Right? Now, this is a little calculation to do, because we have to compute, say, this alpha x alpha, alpha p alpha. Well, here there's nothing to compute actually, right? What do you expect this to be? I've already written it, right? It's this thing, right? And this is this thing here, right? In terms of alpha. So I mean, one can check it, of course. You plug this A dagger here, expression in terms of A dagger, you verify that in the end you get this. But this is what it should be. And so then the next is to compute. So then this gives X, this gives P. And remember that delta X and delta P are given by square root of X. X square minus X square, right? And similar for P. So this is already done, is given by this thing here. Take the square, you get what you get. The only little calculation to do is to take, for example, alpha X square alpha, right? And P square, which is alpha. X is, okay, we said, take out the h bar and omega. This is alpha. A dagger, a plus a dagger over square root of 2 squared, right? This is what x squared is, no? Okay. These are operators now. These are still oscillator operators, right? So I have to compute this thing here. OK? Okay, so this is, you open up this, this is a 2, which I can take it out here, 2 here. The square of this is a square plus a dagger square plus a dagger plus a dagger a. You have to keep track of the ordering, right? Because they don't commute. Of course, you can use the commutation and rewrite this as a dagger is a dagger a, so this plus 1, so this becomes 2 plus 1. So this thing is this. Right? And this is taken between alpha states. Okay. And so this is, since we know that A alpha is equal to alpha alpha, we can compute A square alpha. A square alpha will be just alpha square alpha. So we can compute this, and the same for A dagger acting here. And A dagger we know is alpha mod square and so on. And then you can compute this as a function of this alpha, and then take this thing here, this is x squared, this minus the square of this, and see what you get. Do repeat the calculation for p, take the product that ties delta p, and you should verify that irrespectively of what alpha is, this is always true. So this is left to you as homework to fill, to complete this calculation. Okay? So this is the first thing to check, verify that this is the correct, what you get correctly. Now, what about H, the Hamiltonian? Now, these states are not eigenstates of the Hamiltonian, right? Because they are linear combination of eigenstates, so they are not eigenstates of the Hamiltonian. And remember that when we use the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian, of course, delta H delta H in the states N is equal to zero, right? Because they are eigenstates of the Hamiltonian. So the expectation value delta H is just square root of H square minus H square. But these two are equal, no? Because H N is equal to n h bar omega, okay, whatever, h bar omega, n plus half, n. So they are eigenstates. So this is equal to that. So they are zero. The delta h is zero. The energy is fixed in the state n because it's eigenstate. Of course, this is not true for alpha, right? These are not eigenstates of alpha. Of H. So delta H in the state alpha is different from zero. Okay. So this is also a calculation that you want to do. Actually, you can do. Compute delta H for here we are assuming that alpha is large. The modulus of this number alpha is large because we have neglected the half term, so for alpha large. And you should verify that, let me give you the result, delta H is H bar omega alpha, something like that. So it grows with alpha, Okay? It's large. This is large. So somehow, this is not very intuitive, right? What I'm saying is that these alpha are very close to classical states. Now I'm saying that the variance of the energy is very big. So that looks a little bit contradictory, right? On the other hand, that this is a dimensionful thing. What you should compare actually is delta H, the meaningful thing, delta H over H. So delta H compared to the value of H, right? Because this is meaningful, right? So if H is very large, this is large when alpha is large. This, but this is even larger, right? Because what is the, how delta, how H goes? Well, we said already, right? We impose that H, the expectation value of H is H bar omega alpha square, right? So you see that the ratio delta H over H actually goes to zero for alpha large, right? Delta H over H goes like 1 over alpha, right? So, which is good. For alpha large, this becomes zero, essentially. So then the variance of the energy compared to the energy itself, which is what it makes sense, it is very small. So this is not in contradiction with the interpretation of these states as classical, close to classical. They are quantum, really quantum. These states were introduced in the context of quantum optics by Glauber and others that got Nobel Prize for that. And are very important in studying lasers and this kind of things. Okay.
With growing A, alpha is going to be like a classical oscillator?
Well, yeah, in some sense, to have a picture of, well, it's not like to have a so intuitive picture of what alpha is, it is useful to go to the X representation. In other words, let me just anticipate, this is something that one can compute. Yeah, to see what, because alpha sounds an abstract thing, right? Okay, we checked a few things, but still it's not clear what it is. I mean, so an intuitive picture comes if you write the wave function. Wave function gives the probability distribution in X and so on, right? Before doing that, let me just comment on one more thing. So we have alpha, which is e to the minus alpha square over 2, sum over n, alpha to the n, square root of n factorial n. This is at some fixed time, t equal to 0. Okay? How is the time evolution going? What is the time evolution? Well, time evolution is obtained by applying e to the minus I h t over h bar, right? So alpha of t is e to the minus I h t over h bar on alpha, right? And so let's apply this here. You have to bring this inside, and what is it? It measures the energy of the state, right? So this is this prefactor sum over n. And then when you bring this here, you have e to the minus I, what is h? H is h bar omega, n plus half, right? H bar down, and then t on n. alpha to the n, square root of n factor I, right? This is what you get, right? Now, h bar drops as usual. Omega is the frequency, 1 over time, times time, this is dimension, less as it should be. And notice that this is e to the, so there is something depending on n here. So for each n, there is this n here. And then there is e to the minus I omega half, which is an overall phase, right? I could take it out here, right? But then the overall phases are not relevant, so I could even remove that. So the same state is this e to the minus alpha square over 2. It is equivalent to this state, sum over n. And this n-dependent factor here, I can put together with alpha to the n. This is what? This is alpha e to the minus I omega t to the power n, square root of n factorial, right? No? Minus I omega n t, I put together with alpha to the power n, this is the combination, times n. Okay? So you see that effectively the net result of the time evolution is just to replace alpha with alpha e to the minus I omega t. Right? Because here it doesn't do anything because this is the modulus. So effectively, alpha goes to alpha of t, which is alpha e to the minus I omega t. That's all. Which is the time evolution of alpha, the usual oscillation of alpha. So this is the time evolution of the coherent states. You just give alpha a time dependence, which is a phase, a e to the minus I omega t. This means that the average position and momentum, right, which are related to real imaginary part of alpha, just do an harmonic oscillator behavior, up and down. Right? This should have been expected. Now, okay, so this is the thing. Now, coming back to the question, what is the mean, what is this coherent state, what it looks like? So, the thing which is useful would be something like this. This can be done. We can do that. There is a way of doing it, which is very simple. You have to take x here. You see, there is a complicated way, because if you do, you project on x here, you project this on x, you have the wave function psi n of x, right? But then, to take the infinite sum is not an easy thing, right? To sum the infinite number of Hermite polynomials and with this coefficient in closed form is not an easy thing. There is a way of doing this, which is much simpler. But what you get, let me just anticipate what you get here. The net, you get that this is e to the I, there is a phase, p dot x over h bar. And then some wave function, phi of x minus x, this and that. Okay? And this is just a Gaussian. This is minus x minus x square over time sum constant, the Gaussian, like the ground state wave function. So you see, what is the interpretation of this? This is like this thing here, right? This behavior, this. Centered where? At position, the average position is here, right? And this is a plane wave. right? E to the px over a, with momentum, average momentum p, right? So this is what? This is like a wave packet, which is represented by this Gaussian here, moving with average momentum p, right, in the x direction. Okay, so this is the, this can be done, this calculation is okay, takes a little bit of technique, but can be done. But this is what you get. Okay, this is planes. So they are, this wave packet, so they are very concentrated in x, and there is an average momentum p. Average momentum, average position, and they are have this form in the x space. And if you want to do it for arbitrary time t, you just have to replace alpha of t, and here everything p of t and x of t. So this is the oscillation of the classical oscillator, right?
How could you write the first expression alpha stayed in x spaces? That part I missed, I guess.
Okay, yeah, this is what you have to do, this. This, you have to project this on the x basis, right? What is x alpha? From this expression, is e to the minus alpha square over 2, sum over n, alpha to the n, square root of n factorial, xn, right? This is true. And these are the psi n of x, which are, remember, e to the minus x square over 2, then Hermite polynomials, right? So in principle this is correct, but it's hard to do the calculation this way because you have to do this sum in closed form, otherwise not very useful, right? Sum over, okay, this can be taken out, there is no problem, but you have to sum the Hermite polynomials with these coefficients from 0 to infinity. There may be ways, I'm not saying this, no, but this is not the simplest procedure to do this. There is an alternative procedure. I will explain now. So in the end, the result that you get after doing this calculation, of course, not obvious, is something like this.
But we don't see any dependence on alpha in the last result.
No, alpha is here, right? What is alpha? Is p is x plus ip over square root of 2, right? Real imaginary part, this is alpha, this is alpha. No?
So if we let alpha go to the infinity, so we choose we can, then what happens? Can we write through this equation what I cannot do now?
What?
What happens as alpha goes to infinity?
But alpha goes to infinity is what? It's either large x or large momenta, right? Because of this, no? Alpha, the modulus of alpha is x squared plus p squared, right? Over 2. Okay. It's very, for large x, you see, this is a Gaussian, goes to to zero very rapidly, right? Because, right? Well, actually, no, I'm referring to this x. This x is the average position, is the center of this Gaussian, right? You move in that direction, on that side, very far. And p, okay, p is big momenta, so.
But
should be a correspondence with the classical picture of harmonic oscillator.
Well, it is, there is, yeah. This explains, you know, because this means that the wave function of this object is very peaked, is narrow around the average position, right? So, okay, it's not fixed position, but still, I mean, this is quantum.
Yeah.
But okay. Is as close as possible to a classical position. I mean, there is a little bit of fuzziness here, but otherwise it's very much concentrated around x. And the average momentum is p. So it's a wave packet which moves with the momentum p along the x axis. Okay.
What happened with the time
evolution? Time evolution is very simple, because time evolution, we have not, since we have this, okay?
So just when oscillator, yeah, will become small,
x will go to x cosine omega t? No.
So the position will spread?
No, there will be no spread. This is another important point, which I did not have much time to explain. If you have a free particle, right? A plane wave, we said this is not normalizable, right? Because plane wave has constant norm. But you can form wave packets, yeah, right? By superimposing something like that. So you can form wave packets which are Gaussians like this. Okay, psi of x, instead of being flat, modulus square being flat, it is concentrated, it's a Gaussian. So it's very similar to this situation. However, if you study the time evolution of a free wave packet, okay, where the Hamiltonian is just p square over the 2m, no potential, you find that as time increases, okay, the weight here, this is at time t equal to zero, if t becomes large, this becomes something like this. This is delta. So delta, the spread, increases with time for the free wave packet. So if you localize it at some time t, as the time moves, it will become spread. Okay? This is not the case for this wave function, because the spread of this wave function will be always the same, because the time evolution is just given by replacing p and x average position with the time dependence. So this will mean that this position, center position, will oscillate here, but this width here will remain the same.
When the center position just oscillate, I guess the whole wave packet that we have should oscillate also.
Yeah, it oscillates, but what I'm saying, the width of the wave packet remains fixed.
Remains fixed, yeah, I see.
Whereas in the free case, where this is the Hamiltonian, there is no potential, the wave packet that you prepare at some time t equal to zero does not remain with fixed width, but becomes the width, in the other word, this delta here, is a function of time, and it increases with time, proportional to t. So as for t going to infinity, it becomes very much spread. It's not concentrated anymore.
But we have only the formula e to the r, which means that the plane wave just go,
yeah,
by direction, and you said that it's oscillated, so
yeah,
where's the other direction? E to the r minus I average?
No, well, p, you know, the x oscillates because x goes to x of t is, say, some x cosine omega t, right? Mm-hmm. And p also, p is p sine omega t.
So being inside inside average B we have minus sine.
Yeah, of course. When sine change sine, the cosine and sine change become positive and negative, right? So.
But yeah, but in this case, okay, I get it. The average is just moving, but the variance is still.
The variance is fixed. This is what I'm saying. The spread, the variance, is always fixed. Whereas for the coherent state, for the free wave packet, the variance is not fixed. Depends on time, and it increases with time. This you could easily get. Maybe if you have time, we can do this as an exercise. But okay. Actually, think on the notes that you have. This must be discussed. The free wave packet. Anyhow, this is what happens. Yeah, essentially, you see, the free case, what you do, you superimpose plane waves, right? This is C of P, some P distribution of plane waves. No? This is the way, if you choose for C of P the Gaussian, you get a Gaussian also in X, right? Because if this is e to the minus P squared, I'm not putting the constants properly, this goes like, this is the same as the minus x squared times a number, right? Times a phase, okay? So the Fourier transform of a Gaussian is also a Gaussian, right? But the time evolution is different. Now, how do you do time evolution? This is psi of x at, say, t equal to 0. How do you do time evolution? You have to put the Hamiltonian, the energy. The proper, no? E to the minus I, E, T over H bar, right? Factor, no? So this is a superposition of different eigenstates of the momentum, right? E to the I, P dot X, the plane wave, as a fixed momentum, right? Now, for a fixed momentum, what is the energy? P squared over 2m. So this factor here is e to the minus I h, and e is p squared over 2m times t. You have to include this here, right? To find psi x of t. Okay? This is what time dependence is giving. Now, okay, this is, before, without that, it was a very simple Gaussian. Now, it's still a Gaussian, right? Apart from this I here, which is a little bit tricky, but this integral can be still done. You see, it's not very different from the period. But there is an important factor here, and this factor brings a time here. Now, if you do the integral, this integral, you still find the Gaussian in X, but the variance will depend on T, and will grow with T. This is what you find. You can do this calculation. There is an addition of a term to this term of this form, which is due to the energy, time dependence.
So the end result, the variance in psi, depending on t, which t makes it grow with growing t. Yeah. But on the that side, we have a t dependence, but in an oscillating way. So the width is oscillating, actually.
The width is not oscillating, the width is fixed. The position of the of this Gaussian moves. The center moves, but the size is only the same. Here it will be something like this, the same. The delta x will be fixed here. Not time dependence. this is time dependent, x of t, the position. So this is the feature of the coherent states. They remain stable. Once you do the wave packet some time, they will remain the same for all times, apart from the oscillation, of which is there also classically, right? The classical oscillation of the position, average position, and average momentum. So it's a very classical picture.
So in a sense, we can also bring, for example, one electron in such a coherent state, and it moves like a classical oscillator, although it's one electron.
Yeah, if it is subject to some harmonic potential like that. This was applied in, as I said, in optics to the electromagnetic field, to the photon field, okay? Which, as I was mentioned the other time, when you quantize a field, it's like a collection of harmonic oscillators. Not just single harmonic, but many harmonic oscillators depending on the wave number. And this picture of coherent states was invented for that, for discussing that situation. Okay, let me just mention one more thing, which is the following. There is an operator which involves exponentials of A and A dagger. Let me call D alpha e to the alpha A dagger alpha. A dagger minus alpha star A. This is a complicated operator, right? It involves exponentials of harmonic oscillator operator A dagger, right? These are alpha star are the complex number alpha that I introduced before. Now the point is that with this operator here, you can verify that d of alpha applied to the ground state of the oscillator give precisely the coherent state alpha. Okay? How to see this? First of all, what are the properties of D of alpha? D of alpha is unitary. Because this is anti-Hermitian operator, right? Because this is an operator minus the Hermitian conjugate, no? So it is anti-Hermitian, right? The exponential of an anti-Hermitian operator is unitary. And then you rewrite it in the following way. Remember that whenever you have the product of two operators, e to the a, exponential two operators, e to the a to the b, which not necessarily commute with each other. This is in general a complicated thing, right? If you want to put them in a single exponential, if they commute, becomes e to the a plus b, right? If they don't commute, in general, this is an infinite series on the right-hand side. But if this happens, if a and b commute, if the commutator A with B commutes with A or B, this is equal to zero, then it stops at the next stage, which is 1/2 A. In general, there is infinite series, but if this commutator here commutes with this and that, it stops here, because the extra terms involves extra commutators, which are vanishing. So this is a formula which is, I think, should be familiar to you, or no? Okay, so here we have this situation, right? So this means that e to the a plus b I can invert this relation, right? This is e to the 1 half a commutator b e to the a e to the b minus 1 half. Because this commutes with everything, so, right? So I can write this as e to the alpha a dagger e to the minus alpha star a, and then the commutator, this is say a and this is b, right? The commutator alpha a dagger, alpha star a is what? Is minus, so this is alpha mod square, right?
Yeah.
Right? Because a dagger a is minus one, right? So I can write this in the following way. So this is, let's say, a and b, so this is e to the minus this commutator alpha mod square, and then there is a factor of 2 because of these 2 here, right? So this is the net result, okay? Now, if you apply this, let's apply this to the vacuum, to the ground state, this is a number, e to the minus alpha mod square over 2, and then I have this alpha a dagger e to the minus alpha star a, sorry, a is here, on the ground state, right? Okay, this is what you have. But now, you see, this is 1 minus alpha star a plus alpha star a square over 2, etc., applied to the ground state, no? But this all annihilates the ground state, so what remains is only 1. So here, effectively, this is 1. Right? Okay? So this is e to the minus alpha square over 2. And then you expand this exponential in power series, and you get what? Sum over n alpha a dagger power n, n factorial on 0. Right? But then you use the fact that a dagger to the power n on the vacuum is square root of n factorial over times n, right? Okay, so this cancels half of this, so this you get that this is alpha to the n, this is n, and this is square root of n factorial. So this is precisely the coherent state that we introduced before. Okay? And so this is an alternative way of writing the coherent state as an operator involving exponentials of creation and annihilation operators. So it's a complicated thing, no? We are used to just powers, no? Not infinite series. But okay, this is the way, because after all, this is a full series. No? And actually, with the help of this operator, since alpha is d of alpha 0, it makes life easy if you want to compute the ground state, the wave function, this thing here. This is nothing but x alpha is x d of alpha of that. And it turns out that with this expression, this calculation can be carried and gives precisely what I was saying. Maybe one of these, next time we will sketch this calculation, okay? This can be, one can get this result here. Using tricks like that, you know. First of all, you have to rewrite A and A dagger, say alpha and alpha star as X and P, right? And then using this formula, you can rewrite it. Maybe we'll do it next time, just a sketch of the calculation. Okay. Yeah. Questions?
Is there a name for this operator?
I don't know. This, by the way, this type of operators actually enter in exponential or harmonic oscillator operator like that, enter in string theory calculations. Turns out. For reasons, okay. Yeah, it's related to the coherent state. Yeah, right. So you had some calculation to do? There was this question, right? So what is the answer to the question? Yes or no?
Yes,
okay. It's a very, okay, it's a kind of trivial thing, right? Since the generators are anti-symmetric, it's enough to take a state which is just a real state, right? To take a state which is made of real coefficients, right?
Yes.
Alpha, beta, gamma. And then here you have alpha, beta, gamma, if alpha and beta and gamma are real, right, and normalize them, sum of the squares is equal to 1, then all the generators here, the S's, are anti-symmetric, no? And then it's clearly zero, this, because it's an anti-symmetric matrix, and then let's give us zero. If this is complex, then this is alpha star, beta star, gamma star, and then this is not necessarily zero, right? Because they are different from alpha, beta, gamma, right? That's all.
If they share the face,
eh?
If they share the face, they still...
Yeah, if it's just an overall face, of course, yeah.
Yes, in that case, it's also the origin of the vector, so it is still symmetric and the product is uncertain.
So that then this feature of that, yeah, the fact that you cannot have zero expectation value is only true for the spin half. Yeah. Yeah. Since we are there on the spin half, let me give you some extra thing to do to practice with on that case. You see, we have always taken to be, for example, the Hamiltonian to be h bar omega sigma 3, right? So, see, because we said, okay, so if you have this particle spin half object in a magnetic field, you can always take the magnetic field to be constant, of course, in the third direction, you don't lose any generality, right? And then they show the eigenstates are plus or minus, right? As usual. But okay, suppose instead I give you H magnetic field in the arbitrary in a generic direction, right? The generic direction would mean that H, the magnetic field, is some H times some unit vector, right? In three space, no? Which is some unit vector which specifies the direction, right? 1, 2, 3. And H is the modulus, no? The size of the magnetic field. Now this is the general situation, right? In which case, the Hamiltonian, since the Hamiltonian is H proportional to H dot S, right? For some number here. The Hamiltonian will be something like H bar omega, that is just for dimensional reasons, and then N dot sigma, right? No? Where N, you can always parameterize N in this way, right? This is, for example, the angle theta, and then this is the angle phi. No? Remember that theta goes from 0 to pi, and phi goes from 2 pi 0, right? This is the parametrization usually. And then you have that, so N1 is, say, this is unit length, no? Sine theta cos phi, sine theta sine phi, and this is cos theta, right? So this is the general case, right? Well, you plug this here. So you may ask, okay, first of all, what will be the eigenvalues of this Hamiltonian? That is easy. You don't need to do my calculation. What will be? Yeah, plus or minus H bar omega, because in any case N dot sigma square, the square of this, is what? Is 1, right? Because this is Ni sigma I, Nj sigma j, right? Now sigma I sigma j, yeah, you have to get practice with this algebra. Sigma I sigma j is delta ij plus I epsilon I j k sigma k, right? This is the rule, this is the multiplication table for the sigmas, right? So this is an I and j. And then this thing here, sigma I, sigma j, this is symmetric in ij, so only this contributes, right? Because this is epsilon, it gives zero. So this is n I and j delta ij, which is equal to 1, because n squared is equal to 1. No, this is the calculation. But, okay, so the eigenvalues are plus or minus h bar omega. That is easy. What about the eigenstates? Okay, one can proceed in the usual way, but okay, I mean, write this operator here and compute eigenvalues, which we know what they are, and compute the eigenvectors. There is a way which uses the following fact that it is very important, is that the Pauli matrices, if you take G, an element of SU2, then G minus 1 sigma I G is a rotation, is of the form R I J sigma J. Well, this is a SO3 rotation in three dimensions, okay? This is a general rule. You can use that to do this to rotate sigma 3, we started with the sigma 3, in the generic direct 3 in this direction n, right? So g minus 1 sigma 3 g. Now we have to choose what g is. Okay. So g is the SU2 element. So first, so from the 3, what you do? First you do, for example, rotate 3 on the plane, on this plane, or on this plane, by an angle theta. So you move it, if you have first here, you move it here, for example, theta. And then you move it here by a rotation phi, right? This you can do. No? It's easy to see that this can be realized in the following. If you take g to be e to the I theta sigma 2 over 2 and e to the I phi sigma 3 over 2. Okay? Product of 2. So this does the rotation around the third axis of an angle phi, and this does the rotation on the around the second axis of rotation theta, of an angle theta. I'm claiming this is true, okay? So then it's a matter of verifying it. You see? So g minus 1, let me write, what is g minus 1? Is e to the minus I theta sigma 2 over 2, right? E to the minus I phi sigma 3 over 2, no? G minus 1 times g is 1. So then you plug this here, and this you plug here. So the first thing is, so you have e to the minus I phi sigma 3 over 2, e to the minus I theta sigma 2 over 2, sigma 3, e to the I theta sigma 2 over 2, e to the phi sigma 3. This is the calculation to be done, right? Okay. And then, okay, first you do this, right? And then you do the other. Okay, to do these calculations, I mean, you can choose either first of all, for example, what is this e to the I theta sigma 2 over 2? How do you write it? You expand the exponential, right? And this is equal to what?
Cosine theta plus I sigma 2.
Theta or theta over 2? Theta or theta over 2? What do you think? Then you have plus I sigma 2 and sine theta over 2. This is this thing. This is a general formula. If you have a different angle, phi, you will have phi here, and if you have sigma 1 or sigma 3, you will have sigma 1 or, sorry, this is 2, sigma 2. No.
Identity.
And this is the identity, right? So this is the expression. Let me just sketch the first step. So the first step is you have it, if this is plus or minus, this is plus or minus, right? So e to the minus I theta sigma 2 over 2 sigma 3 theta sigma 2 over 2, this is cos theta over 2 minus I sine theta over 2 sigma 2 sigma 3, right? Cos theta over 2 plus I sine theta over 2 sigma 2. This is what it is, right? And now you have to perform this calculation, right? So there will be a time involving sigma 3. Sigma 3 will become with cosine theta 2 square, this times that, right? And then sigma 2, sigma 3, sigma 2, once you pass this, you get a minus sign. Sigma 2 square is 1. So this is minus, because minus I plus I is 1. There is another minus, you have sine square theta over 2, this is sigma 3. Sigma 3 is here. What is this? Cosine theta over 2 square minus sine theta over 2 square. This is cos theta. Times sigma 3. A general feature of this calculation is that you start with a half here in these matrices, but when you do this thing g minus 1 sigma g, you don't get any half, okay, in the angles. So this is the sigma 3 term, and then there is the mixed terms, right? Sigma 2, sigma 3, and then sigma 3, sigma 2, right? And this come with, so there is minus I sine theta over 2, sigma 2, sigma 3, times cosine theta over 2, right? This term is what? Sigma 2, sigma 3 is I sigma 1. So this is sine theta over 2, cosine theta over 2, sigma 1. And there is the other term giving the same contribution, again, so a factor of 2, sine theta over 2, cosine theta over 2, sigma 1. And this is what? This is sine theta. So, all in all, you have cosine theta sigma 3 plus sine theta sigma 1. Okay? Now, this is precisely what you expect, right? Because, let's see, you have sigma 3, the third direction is here. So, we do, so this is 1, 2, and 3. Okay? We do a rotation around the second axis, because here we had sigma 2, of an angle theta. No? So this moves here, right? This is theta. So it acquires a component which is cos theta along the third direction, which is sigma 3 cos theta, and then a component along the first direction, which is sine theta, which is this. Along the first direction, which is this. So this is precisely what this operation does, right? To rotate sigma 3 on the plane around this axis here. Okay? And then you have to do the other. Then you have to bring, so now our unit vector is here, and then you have to bring it here, right? In some generic position. This is done by doing a rotation around the third axis by an angle phi, which is precisely this thing here, the second step. And then you should get what the end of this calculation should be, precisely n dot sigma. So I leave it to you to do this, complete this calculation. So this is the familiar map that you will see in SU2, and probably you have already seen it in group theory course. From SU2, these are SU2 elements, because they are 2 by 2 unitary matrices of determinant 1, so SU2, to SO3. SO3 are the rotations of a vector in three-dimensional space, which are these things here. Okay. So you do this, and then from this calculation, you should be able also to guess, I mean, to see what would be to use this calculation to, we have this sigma dot eta times some eigenstate, instead of sigma 3, which was before, sigma 3 has eigenstate plus and minus 1, 0, 0, 1. This matrix here has still eigenvalues plus 1 and minus 1, as we said already, but the eigenstate will be different, right? Not 1, 0, 0, 1, will be different. So, from this calculation, you should be able to guess what will be the eigenstate of this. Using the fact that g minus 1 sigma 3g gives n dot c. In other words, the transformation that you need to do on the eigenstate of sigma 3, which is 1, 0, 0, 1, to get the eigenstate of this matrix here. This is the okay, so complete this calculation that I was sketching to prove that this is true, where n is what I wrote before here, which is here, this one, and then use this to get the eigenstate, the two eigenstates of n dot sigma with eigenvalue plus 1 and minus 1. So these are the two things to do. This, the previous thing about the harmonic oscillator, to compute the variance of delta x delta p in the coherent state, check that is h bar over 2, and then this. You have anything to give me for this?